Welcome, I'm Scott Eyerly. I'm on the faculty of the Juilliard School Evening Division, their Department of Lifelong Learning. I'll be talking tonight about the opera, Aida. Delighted to have you with us here. Before we start, a couple of very quick announcements. Registration is now open for the Juilliard summer classes. There's some wonderful courses being offered. I feel that in this very uncertain time, there's value in having some plans. If you are so inclined, please go to juilliard.edu/summer-series. That's one word, and you can investigate the offerings. It's kind of nice to know that you've got something coming up to look forward to other than streamed Netflix. Number two, if you enjoy these lectures but have not been getting the invites, or if you do not enjoy these lectures but would like to get the invites, which is a kind of less clear way of thinking. Either way, you can go again to juilliard.edu/get updates, and there's a little dash between get and updates. So again, that's juilliard.edu/get-updates. And you can click the box continuing education, and that will advise you of these weekly Friday lectures. Folks, I'm delighted tonight to talk about the opera Aida by Giuseppe Verdi. In the world of fashion, there are models and there are supermodels, faces instantly recognizable even to those who don't read Vogue. In the arts, there are works and there are superworks, titles instantly familiar to people, even if they don't hang out in museums and theaters. Chances are good that, whether or not somebody has read the play, they've heard of Hamlet. Whether or not they visited the Vatican, they've heard of the Sistine Chapel. And whether or not they've walked past an opera house, they've heard of Aida. The very name brings to mind spear carriers, a wailing soprano, and a stage crammed with camels. Aida has broken into pop culture as well. Elton John wrote a musical on the same story, and Larry Hart slipped it into the song Johnny One Note, where he rhymed the title with Indeed Ah. Why so? How has Aida become an iconic name? I suggest four reasons. Let's get the obvious one out of the way first, the music. Verdi drenches us with melody like few other composers. Second, body mass index. This term does not appear in the Harvard Dictionary of Music. I mean that in both score and libretto, a high percentage of the writing is lean, a low percentage is flabby. Characters don't ramble on. Musical sections don't extend unnecessarily. Granted, 19th century audiences lived at a speed less caffeinated than ours. Still, for an opera so grand, Aida carries very little fat on its bones. This hit me the last two times I saw the opera. A few years ago in Verona, Italy, I attended a performance of Aida at the famed arena. Built in Roman times, the Arena di Verona draws 15,000 spectators each night, much like this lecture series, though my webcam can't swivel to show you the mobs just off screen. Then, a few months later, I caught a performance of Aida at the Met. In both Verona and New York, it struck me how smartly paced this opera is. Much as one says of a large athlete, he moves well for his size, so we may say of Aida, for a mammoth opera, it moves along well. Yes, there are moments of stasis and spectacle, but they're no longer than they should be, while the intimate scenes advance at a good clip. Those intimate scenes, I consider the third reason for Aida's success. One marvels at how much of this grand opera isn't grand. Verdi and his librettists wisely focus on personal drama, against which war and statehood form a backdrop, rather than the other way around. In fact, despite its reputation for excess, most of this piece is small scale. Truly, if we rendered on a pie chart how many minutes elapse for the crowd scenes, they'd amount for a modest slice of the pie. Most other scenes feature only two or three characters. Verdi knew what holds our interest is human relationships. Author J.D. Salinger observed, "Joy is a liquid, happiness is a solid. We might say that on stage, spectacle is a liquid, human relationship is a solid." A fourth reason for the opera's popularity may be high concept. That term crops up in TV and film, meaning a work that can be summarized in one sentence. For example, science teacher learns he's terminally ill and starts making crystal meth. That's the series Breaking Bad. Or men on canoe trip in Appalachia fight creepy backwoods people. That's the movie Deliverance. Many operas are high concept. For example, earnest Japanese girl marries shallow American naval lieutenant, Puccini's Madama Butterfly. Or lady killer seduces many women until his past catches up with him, Mozart's Don Giovanni. Aida could be summed up, army leader loves enemy slave girl. Or you could simply say, guy and gal on opposite sides fall in love. Even Verdi admitted the idea was somewhat old-fashioned, but old-fashioned ideas can be effective. Witness the phenomenal success of Downton Abbey, only a few decades before that hit. Upstairs, Downstairs told a similar story about an upper-crust English family and its servants. One imagines a BBC exec rejecting the pitch for Downton Abbey, saying, "It's been done," and he would have been correct. But people like stories about upper-crust English families and their servants, just as people like stories about lovers who shouldn't love each other, whether for reasons of state, class, race, or fill in the blank. Despite its familiar theme, the story is original. In other words, not adapted from a book or play, as is far more common. Very few operas, or musicals for that matter, are built from scratch. Such disparate works as The Marriage of Figaro, West Side Story, Madama Butterfly, and Hello, Dolly existed in other forms before being musicalized. But a French archaeologist and Egyptologist named Auguste Mariette invented a scenario and proposed it to Camille Dulocle, director of the Opéra Comique in Paris. Mariette knew that the Khedive of Egypt had wanted Verdi to write something to open the Cairo Opera House, not the Suez Canal, as popular belief may have it, but the composer had declined. The opera house duly opened in 1869 with Verdi's Rigoletto, which was already 18 years old. The Khedive still wanted a new opera from Verdi, a wish Mariette expressed to Dulocle. When Verdi rebuffed the idea, other composers were suggested, Wagner or Gounod. Was it this that changed Verdi's mind, the competition, or was it Mariette's scenario about an Ethiopian girl in love with an Egyptian soldier, or was it the huge fee? Dulocle expanded on Mariette's French language scenario, and Antonio Ghislanzoni created the Italian language libretto. Verdi, who disliked travel, did not attend the Cairo premiere, on Christmas Eve, 1871, but he was present at the La Scala premiere 6 weeks later. Both events were spectacular successes. The happiness of those premieres contrasts markedly with the tragedy of the plot. Spoiler alert, things don't end well. Italian drama is not normally solution-based. Its outcomes are not Solomonic. The people who wrote them would not succeed as business consultants. Can you imagine a CEO approaching Deloitte and Touche, explaining a problem and getting the response, "It's hopeless. How un-American. We expect to overcome obstacles, not 19th century Italian opera audiences. A fraught situation at the start will not be worked out through focus groups. In this fatalistic world, lovers who are doomed are, well, doomed." When my opera, The House of the Seven Gables, received its premiere, a very cultured English writer praised my work, but wondered if the ending was too happy, possibly because I'm American. I believe we enjoy Aida most when we sit back, enjoy the music, and accept that everyone will end up dead or miserable. Let's move on to the story and score. One clue to the opera's character is its orchestral prelude. We might expect bombast, but Verdi starts almost inaudibly with a theme linked to Aida herself. Intriguingly, it's not entirely clear what key we're in for the first 10 seconds. In other words, we can't tell which note represents closure, for Verdi delays this note, the so-called tonic note. Even then, we're not sure if the mode is major or minor. Verdi also sprinkles in pitches from different keys. I'll play the opening now on the piano, please forgive me for having to turn my back to you, and I'll point out when he finally sounds that tonic note. I'm not saying that Verdi here foreshadows 20th century music, but this ambiguity well expresses Aida's conflicted state. Here's the opening. Here's tonic. Only there does the music settle into a traditional key, and only temporarily. The whole prelude lasts under 5 minutes, compact indeed for a 19th century opera. Let's listen now to the opening minute. Tonight, our audio excerpts come from a 1962 studio recording. Sir George Schulte conducts the Orchestra of Rome Opera. Act one begins in surprisingly low-key fashion. The setting is ancient Egypt, yet we see neither chariots nor lions. Nothing but two guys conversing. This is the grandest of grand operas. It starts like a Thornton Wilder play. Here, the high priest, named Ramphis, tells the soldier, Radames, that their enemy, Ethiopia, may attack again, and that the goddess Isis has chosen the commander of Egypt's forces, a name to be revealed soon. Alone, Radames hopes he's the chosen one, not only for glory, but because it ought to really impress his beloved Aida. A vocal coach told me that if an opera contains four memorable tunes, it will survive in the repertory. Aida must contain 24 at least. As proof of this superabundance, one of the most famous melodies in opera occurs now, just minutes into the show, Radames' Celeste Aida, or Heavenly Aida. We'll hear a sample. The beginning presents a notorious challenge for tenors because the opening phrases end on a high note, which falls on a weak beat. That's a dangerous combination. So the tenor must avoid doing this. Celestida, forma divina. Those last notes should not be overemphasized as I grotesquely did, and I sang it in a lower key. However, reining them in is difficult. One opera critic remarked that when he attended performances of Aida, he could tell right away how good the tenor was going to be by how he handled those opening phrases. Here's John Vickers. Aria's tempo, moderate. Typically in Verdi's time, a principal's first aria, like this one, would be in just such a tempo, and the vocal part wouldn't be especially showy, a type of aria called the cantabile. The cantabile would then lead to a faster, showier aria called the cabaletta. Verdi, however, by this point in his career, resisted such conventions, using them only when dramatically justified. Therefore, Radames does not sing a cabaletta. Instead, the action zips right along with the entrance of Amneris, the king's daughter. The princess has goo-goo eyes for Radames, but fears that he loves another. Our next audio will start with her entrance. Notice the orchestra's unhurried, graceful melody, suggesting privilege. It sounds like this. Amneris doesn't sing that melody. Instead, she sings simpler music in counterpoint with it. When the princess notices Radames gleaming, she knows he just got big applause for his aria. Still, she worries about his affections, In turn, Radames fears she's guessed his secret. Then they talk to themselves. Now, think how odd that would be in real life. Two people alone in a room, muttering separately. If I walked into a Starbucks and saw two people in opposite corners chatting to no one and with no earbud, I'd walk out. But it's common in opera. Notice the accompaniment, an agitated figure, which nobody will sing, at least not completely. Instead, the principals join in with it for mere fragments at a time. That passage lasts only 45 seconds, then everything quiets down with Aida's first entrance. We know she's coming before she steps on stage by her theme in clarinet. You'll be able to follow text and translations for several of tonight's audio excerpts. This is one of them. I'll pull up the lyrics in a moment. The role of Amneris is for mezzo, a voice category which is not only lower than soprano, but several shades darker. Our Amneris tonight is Rita Gore. Besides being a slave, Aida is Ethiopian, in other words, the enemy. wow, what if she were the woman Radames secretly loved? Wouldn't that be something? Of course, we know this is so, even if it takes Amneris another act to figure it out. But now the king appears with retinue. A messenger announces that Ethiopia has attacked, led by the fearsome Amonasro. Aida gasps at the name of her father, yet no one hears her because this is opera. The king reveals the name of the warrior Isis chose to command their army, and it is Radames. Our next audio demonstrates Verdi's mastery of both large scale and small scale. First, we'll hear massed forces wishing victory in a steady, march-like refrain, adorned with a solo line for Aida. The tempo quickens with cries of guerra, war. Suddenly, one voice calls out, ritorna vincitor, meaning return victorious. That voice, belonging to Amneris, addressed to Radames, is echoed by chorus. All exit except Aida. With no stop for applause, Aida bitterly repeats those words, ritorna vincitor, wondering how she could have uttered them against her own people. In about 20 seconds, the stage population has gone from 90 people to one person, and the music, in both cases, perfectly suits the moment. Here now is a bit of the choral march and Aida's first solo lines sung by Leontyne Price. Notice that after she echoes the phrase ritorna vincitor, her next words lie low in register in what's called chest voice. Thus begins the first of Aida's two great solos. Each solo requires of the soprano a huge range of emotion and of vocal technique. That dark chest voice we just heard is but one of the singing styles Verdi demands. A very different one appears on our next audio clip. Lyric, lighter, higher in the voice. We might almost think a different soprano is singing. Here, approaching the end of the aria, Aida calls on the gods to show pity.
Sing me,
There follows a scene in the temple where priestesses invoke a spirit and the high priest blesses Radames. A hard-boiled dramatist would say this section could be cut without harm to the story. True, it basically provides color and atmosphere. Critic Roger Parker describes the scene as, quote, an old-fashioned tableau, so beloved of French grand opera, end quote. But even here, Verdi keeps things moving. The tableau lasts barely 10 minutes, and did I mention, the music is fabulous. It's also enriching the mood as a kind of calm before the storm on the eve of battle. Let's hear the opening. Harp, often used to suggest antiquity, repeats simple chords while an offstage soprano, the high priestess, invokes the deity. Her song uses an unusual scale, lending the music a non-Western color. Then you'll hear a chorus of priests intoning softly. Act two starts in a private room of Amneris as a swarm of slave girls adorns her for the victory celebration. But she still harbors suspicions about Aida. Alone with the slave, Amneris declares, Radames was killed in action. Aida shrieks. Then Amneris says, I lied. Radames lives. Aida exults. Now that the situation is clear, Amneris warns Aida to abandon hope, saying, you're a slave and I'm the Pharaoh's daughter. Aida replies, yeah, but you're the mezzo and I'm the soprano. Think about that. That's not true. Actually, Aida feels defeated. In our next audio, she acknowledges Amneris' power while Amneris tells the slave to tremble. Suddenly, offstage trumpets interrupt them, a classic intrusion of the public on the private. This conflict recurs throughout Verdi's work. For example, in such works as Un ballo in maschera, where the governor enjoys success in politics, but heartbreak in romance, or Don Carlo, where the king realizes he can rule half of Europe, but not his wife. Verdi seized on the tension between patriotism and personal happiness. The trumpets are announcing a parade to commemorate Egypt's victory. Offstage chorus resumes the refrain we heard earlier. Against it, Amneris boasts of her superiority to Aida. So let's begin with a bit of their scene alone, leading to the outside celebration.
Hey.
Scene two takes place before the gates of Thebes, but really the stage direction should say, scene two takes place anywhere you can fit in 1 billion people. For here occurs the triumphal procession, the grandest scene in all opera, as troops, animals, and kitchen sinks parade before the king. Earlier, I noted that Aida's intimate passages outnumber its opulent ones, but that doesn't mean its big moments aren't jaw-dropping. A friend of mine likes to introduce newcomers to opera by taking them to Aida Act Two. Just Act Two. I applaud his idea. For sheer wow factor, this scene can't be beat. The term grand opera doesn't have a precise definition in the manner of terms like rondo form or string quartet. It's like the word blockbuster is used for a film. It triggers assumptions, but nothing more. One thing, though, grand opera implies is all hands on deck. Every resource of an opera company will appear at some point, not just principals and supporting singers, but also chorus, lots of chorus, and ballet, plus a few spear carriers if available. Verdi's triumphal procession includes all these things. I'll play two excerpts. First, there's a certain march you might have heard. Imaginatively, it's known as the Triumphal March from Aida. The composer directed its famous trumpet melody to be played on stage, not in the pit, on instruments of a type specially made for the opera's premiere. March leads to a ballet, which any lesser composer would have made 20 minutes long. Verdi keeps it compact, about 5 minutes in length, but brimming with colorful ideas. Here's a brief sample. This display, Verdi doesn't forget human emotion. When the king asks Radames to name his reward, Radames calls forth the Ethiopian prisoners. Among them, Aida recognizes her father, a revelation which amazes the crowd. They'd be more amazed if they realized her father is Amonasro, the Ethiopian leader, but he's dressed like the other captives and whispers to Aida not to reveal his identity. Addressing the Egyptian king, Amonasro calls himself a poor soldier who witnessed the death of his own king, Amonasro, on the field. He pleads for clemency. Subsequent events in the opera wouldn't work if we didn't care about Amonasro. Had Verdi given him only cursory lines of recitative, in other words, speech-like passages, then the Ethiopian king would remain a generic figure, like the Egyptian king, who, by the way, is not given a name. He's identified merely as Il Re, the king. And guess what? We don't care about him. But as our next audio shows, Verdi wrote impassioned melody for the adding intensity to the baritone voice, a classic example of the Verdi baritone. Notice also the music's hymn-like character and its repetition by Aida with chorus. Then we'll hear a bit of contrasting music as the Egyptian priests call for the Ethiopian's death. Robert Merrill sings Amonasro. Asks that the prisoners be freed. The king agrees so long as Amonasro remains behind, both as a pledge of security and because there's a terrific father-daughter scene coming up in Act 3. Additionally, the king bestows on Radames the hand of his daughter, Amneris. Whoops. With the reprise of the triumphal march, the curtain falls on Act 2. When you take your seat after the second intermission, you can look forward to seeing all the principals again. But there's one thing you won't see again: full chorus. They never come back. A person attending their first ever performance of Aida, after being caught in traffic and thus missing the opening two acts, might almost think it was a chamber opera. Starting with Act 3, frequently only two people are on stage, sometimes just one. Even the choral scenes are limited to either men alone or women alone until the opera's conclusion, when full chorus sings once more, but offstage and essentially for background effect. Act 3 is set on the banks of the Nile. To one side stands the temple of Isis. We'll hear now the opening minute as orchestra conjures a warm desert night. Verdi, one century before Philip Glass, builds this music from a single note passed back and forth in different registers between string sections, suggesting stillness. Solo flute, flitting between major and minor key, adds to the hypnotic effect. Then we'll hear priests from, we will then hear prayers from within the temple. Here is the opening of Act 3. Thank you. Amneris enters the temple for prayers before her wedding. Aida takes the stage, appearing anxious. She's come to meet Radames under cover of night, but since he's not there, she opts to sing her second big solo. Called O Patria Mia, it's an ode to her homeland, which she despairs she'll never see again. This acclaimed monologue was a late addition to the score. Let's hear the opening. Notice Verdi's light scoring, hardly any instruments are playing, and his use of upper register for solo oboe, suggesting frailty or vulnerability. Aida herself sounds vulnerable as she sings unaccompanied at first. Then in the next section, she shifts between major and minor, like the solo flute that introduced the act. Here's what that middle part with the shift between major and minor sounds like. There's major, now it goes back to minor. Again, ending in the major mode. This next audio lasts 3 minutes, but when I pull up the text on screen, you may wonder what's missing. It doesn't look like 3 minutes worth of music. In fact, Verdi repeats a number of lines. Those repetitions are not written out on the printed material, and most of those lines, whether repeated or not, are stretched out at a broad tempo. I will pull up the text in just one moment, if you will pardon me. It is here, and let me pull up our music, and then I'll show you the text. Here is the opening of O Patria Mia. Whoops, I'm so sorry. It will be the opening of O Patria Mia, but it would help if I did this in the right order. Let's do that again. Here is the opening of O Patria Mia. And folks, I'm so sorry. I do know what I'm doing wrong here. Some would say, Scott, giving the lecture at all. But I think I realize where my error lies. Let me get rid of something here. This will make a little bit of difference, and we will come back. This should now give us what we want. Let's try this again. And here is our music, at least. Hopefully I'll get the text as well. Oh! Aida is surprised by Amonazzaro, who's hidden in wait for her. Amonazzaro knows his daughter loves Radames and intended to meet him here. Acting alternately as good cop, bad cop, Amonazzaro reminds Aida of Ethiopia's beauty, then he describes the terrors Egypt has wrought upon them. He adds that his army is forming anew and that Egypt will face them once more. Victory is ours, he says, only if Aida extracts a secret from Radames. What route will the Egyptian army take? Aida is horrified at the thought of betraying her lover, but dad foists enough guilt on daughter to win them a week of appearances on Dr. Phil. Aida relents. Amonazzaro hides when Radames appears. We'll listen now to the moment Aida and her lover are reunited, but notice the extreme difference in vocal writing. Radames pours out melody while Aida, convinced he no longer loves her, answers on a dull, single note. Again, I will pull up the text. Here is the moment of their reuniting. Radames wins over Aida, but her thoughts turn to the imminent conflict. She asks, what road can we take to avoid your army? He says, the road my army will be using later, the gorge of Napata. From behind a rock, a voice repeats, the gorge of Napata. Generally speaking, when you divulge a secret, the sound of your words being repeated from behind a rock is not a good sign. Radames pales to see Amonazzaro and realizes he is himself inadvertently committed treason. Amonazzaro promises him a throne alongside his daughter in Ethiopia, but Radames remains inconsolable. Amneris, who's overheard the events, exits the temple shouting, traitor. Amonazzaro flees with his daughter while Radames surrenders to Egyptian guards. At the Met, as at most houses, no intermission occurs between the final two acts. So, after barely a minute, Act 4 commences. You'll sometimes hear this referred to as Amneris's act, because she's featured in Scene 1, plus she makes a small but vital contribution in Scene 2. At curtain, Amneris, alone, reflects on what's just happened, and veers between anger and regret. She orders Radames brought before her. In our next audio, Amneris tells Radames he must defend himself before the judges. Notice right where we'll start, solo bass clarinet. It plays an obsessive figure with ghostly tone. Notice again the distinctive mezzo voice. Its compass doesn't differ so greatly from that of a soprano voice. Indeed, if you printed the mezzo part of an opera on transparencies and overlaid it on the soprano part of that opera, you'd find most of the notes fall within the same register. But mezzo timbre is much darker, especially the category labeled dramatic mezzo, meaning a heavier, louder voice as here. Adames refuses to defend himself. Amneris reveals that Amonazaro perished in the attempted escape, but Aida still lives. Amneris tells Radames, if I save your life, you must renounce Aida. Again, he refuses and is taken away. From offstage, we thrice hear the judges ask Radames to answer for his actions. Each time he remains mute. The verdict is death. Amneris collapses in rage and remorse. The opera's final scene splits the stage, not vertically as on a computer screen, but horizontally. The upper half shows a temple, the lower half shows a tomb in which Radames has been sealed to die. Soon, Radames discovers he's got company. Aida has slipped in also to die alongside him. They sing a moving farewell to earthly life. Here's the opening refrain, sung by Aida. Notice the large upward gap between her first two notes, a phrase which we'll repeat, perhaps representing a yearning for the unattainable. Keeps vigil outside the tomb. Penitent, she asks that Radames be transported to heaven. Also from above, we hear the priests and priestesses chant to their god. This split-screen effect was Verdi's idea and may be thought to visually represent the public-private conflict noted earlier. Unusually for 19th century opera, the last notes drift away quietly. This most massive of lyric dramas ends with a whimper not a bang, and touches us all the more deeply for it. Tonight's Met stream is notable not only artistically but historically for being Leontyne Price's farewell performance from 1985. I hope you enjoy it. I hope also you will join me next Friday when our opera on tap is Puccini's La Bohème. I can't wait. I hope you have a wonderful week. Enjoy, and thank you.